Media recognition from Bloomberg, Reuters, recycling trade publications. Patented process for 100% recovery of critical metals, including cobalt, lithium, nickel, manganese, aluminum. American Manganese is focused on recycling lithium-ion batteries for electric vehicles. American Manganese trades on the TSX Venture, AMY, the U.S., AMYZF, and Frankfurt 2AM. For more information, visit AmericanManganeseInc.com or phone me, Larry Ray, at 778-574-4444.
You're listening to HowStreet.com Radio, available online at TalkDigitalNetwork.com. Welcome to HowStreet.com Radio, the online source for market opinions. Here is Jim Goddard.
My guest is Danielle Park, editor of the popular blog Juggling Dynamite and president of Venable Park Investment Council Incorporated. Her websites, JugglingDynamite.com and VenablePark.com. Welcome back to the show, Danielle.
Thanks, Jim. Happy end of March.
Well, here in Vancouver, of course, we have flowers blooming all over the place, allergies, very active because of all the pollen in the air, hummingbirds are happy. In Toronto and southern Ontario, you're digging out again.
No, we don't have any snow. We just have 16 and windy today, so March is going out like a bit of a volatile lamb, both in the markets and in the weather.
You did get some freezing rain, though.
Okay.
All right. Last time I visited Toronto, it was freezing rain. You can put that on the flag there, maybe. Anyway, real estate, Canadians very concerned about skyrocketing home prices. And one of the complaints is, well, there just isn't any more land to build on. is that true?
No. That's been the bullish touchstone for centuries through every housing bubble ever that happened, back to the, 1600s in Amsterdam and all different times. They basically always come up with this point that, they're not making more land. And, while that is true that there's only so much land on planet Earth, there's also only so many humans, who want to live in different areas. And, we also are very good at, for example, making concentration of housing, taking down old buildings, old structures, revamping them into multi-home, multi-unit housing, that sort of thing. So there's a lot of natural recycling that goes on in urban areas. But in addition to that, just if you look at the pure physical area around the population centers, there is actually a ton of land where you can see expanding if necessary. What you tend to get, though, and this is part of the squeeze higher, let's say, in these cycles, is that, developers will purchase properties, sit on them for long periods of time, and basically sop up the availability to, wait for prices to pressure higher, and that's a long sort of play. They've been doing that for some time and with good success this cycle. But of course, now we've already seen that the amount of volume of housing starts and building permits and these things are at 50-year highs in North America. At the same time that there was actually a really cool article that I put on the blog, on my blog today, from the Better Dwelling people who just go back and look at the papers and headlines from, the 1930s in Canada, the 1960s, which were also big credit booms and housing bubbles that billowed into their usual peak. And at that time, there's a frenzy, again, in the 80s. An example is in the, late 1989, housing prices peaked out in Canada and really then fell for the next 6 or 7 years and didn't recover that 89 peak till into the early 2000s. That's pretty typical of what we've seen after really massive overinvestment and people paying crazy amounts for their abodes. And so anyway, that's all very typical. And when you look at the headlines from those times in the newspapers, they were all saying the same things, that there's only so much land, that no one's making more of it, that houses pricing never goes down. Of course, all that is not true. What it really is a credit cycle, right? And so this is something we've been able to document through decades and decades and decades. And What's very interesting right now about what's happening is we've known for a long time, of course, we've been talking about ad nauseum, that the pace of acceleration in pricing was really off the charts, especially in places like Canada. I mean, if you look at the long term, like over a 50 or 60 year period, the appreciation in realty prices is more like 5% a year. And of course, we've just been through a period, Jim, where housing has essentially doubled in the last 4 years in Canada. The median home price has gone up from like 580 at the start of the pandemic to 880 today. At the same time, we have, really big shock this month, in the mortgage rate cycle, because you know, the Ukraine invasion coming as it has at the end of the pandemic, when we already had a lot of debt added to the system and a lot of consumption enabled by fiscal programs, free money, handouts, deferrals, all these things that came as emergency support. Well, of course, that's all coming to an end now as the pandemic sort of, the expectation is we're all going back to work, back to normal. People have borrowed more than they should have, and low rates were the elixir that allowed that to happen. Well, now, with the sudden shock to grain and fossil fuel markets from the Russian invasion, we've had this massive jump. You know, the price of oil has basically doubled since December, or it had. It went up to about $125 a barrel on WTIC, and that means that, you know, that is all very typical as well of past cycles, where you get, you know, consumption on credit, particularly through the transmission mechanism of housing, because it's the, you know, the bulk of the world's wealth is in real estate, and when people are really able to borrow and lever that asset, they enable a whole bunch of spending on other goods and furnishing and all that sort of stuff. And so we had that happen, and then you get this big shock in the last month on this invasion where prices spike on these key commodities, and everybody then panics that, oh my goodness, just as we're being called back to work and expecting to commute, prices of gas have gone up so much, et cetera. And so what happens is that there's a great outcry, and this is, again, typical behavior in past cycles to central banks and policymakers to say, you know, do something about this inflation. It's very hard on households. You see, consumer sentiment is already back to levels that were always commensurate with other recessions in the past. So consumers are feeling very tense and stressed in this environment. They have, their savings rate's been drawn down. That anomalous bump that came from all the free money has really been drawn down. And now they're dealing with mortgage payments that, you know, just in the last month, the 5-year bond rate, because of all this talk about central banks hiking rates, you know, they've really whipped into a frenzy of hyperbolic promises about we're going to, you know, hike rates another, we'll be above 2.5% by year end, and, you know, from a starting point of 0.25. So the rate of change here is off the charts, Jim, in terms of the rapidity with which people are expecting central banks to hike rates. So what that happens then is the bond market is a discount mechanism. So it looks at those aspirations and says, fine, central banks want to hike a lot. Okay, so the front end of the curve sells off. At the same time, the long end of the bond curve, the 10, 20s, and 30-year curve, looks out and sees that means the economy is going to slow, because it's all been, you know, propelled on this excessive amounts of stimulus from monetary and fiscal inputs in the past 2 years. We've just had the sharpest rally in the stock market between March of 20 and January, February, just before the invasion happened. We had the sharpest rally in the stock market that we've had since, you know, March of 2000, sort of thing. And that is always a precursor as well to this sort of give back period, because nothing can go up 100% over a 2-year period indefinitely. That's very anomalous behavior. Back to this whole idea of what's the long-term norm for asset appreciation. Well, if the average is maybe 4 or 5% a year, and you've got a doubling of asset prices in the period of 2 years, clearly you're into the you owe some of that back category. So all of that's really happening at the same time, and that means, as I was alluding to, mortgage rates, that, you know, the 5-year fixed rate, which is something that Canadians tend to use quite a bit, was as low as 1.4% in February of 2021, just last February. And with the rate hikes that have happened, the expectation of rate hikes, the repricing that's gone on in the bond market this month, we now have 5-year rates above 4%, Jim. At the same time, as I mentioned, you know, the median house price has gone from, you know, the 580 to the 880, and much more than that in big centers in Ontario and BC, of course, where the median house price is over $1 million. So what you're really seeing is almost a doubling of mortgage payments. So we just have real negative wage growth. There's no way the household has that in the budget to have a doubling of their house prices of their mortgage prices at the same time, by the way, that they've had this big jump in their fuel costs and their food costs and all the other credit facilities. You know, they all float up with these rate increases. So that includes personal and business lines of credit, all of it is really moving higher. So there's an enormous rate shock right now, a financial shock to households and businesses. And that is something that has typically triggered the onset of recession. And I think that's what we're looking at now over the next few months. The prospects of moving into the next recession have really accelerated.
We'll have more with Danielle Park right after this.
Don't miss out. Stay informed. Receive the HowStreet.com weekly recap with thought-provoking podcasts, radio, and articles delivered to your inbox. Sign up for the HowStreet.com weekly recap on our homepage at HowStreet.com.
Welcome back. We're speaking with Danielle Park. Danielle, back in the late 70s, early 80s, Sun Life told its clients, look, you'll make so much of a return on your investment with us, you won't have to pay any premiums. They'll be self-paying. Well, Sun Life lost one of the biggest class actions in Canadian history at the time. I got $12,000 back from them because of it, because simply it's not sustainable. And now we have all kinds of ads saying guaranteed return is the... We heard that story back when inflation was high in the 70s, early 80s. Is this a lie once again? Guaranteed return.
Guaranteed returns that are everything but in most cases, right? And this has been another fallout of this crazy time when central banks pushed the base rates in the banking system to zero and then punched a whole bunch of liquidity into the system so that there's so much cash chasing somewhere to be, and there's so few actually compelling investment opportunities because everything is so extremely overvalued. And when assets are so overvalued, their yields are much lower than when assets are properly valued. So you've had this great race to the bottom in terms of where to put money, and people have been just throwing it at anything and everything. You know, a whole bunch of folks that would have 20 years ago happily owned GICs at the bank and collected 5 or 6% a year have been, you know, convinced that they can't afford to have anything safe because there's just not enough yield. And for just example, you know, government bonds, again, another major asset class that has traditionally been associated with the highest safety, you know, prescribed income payments, guaranteed return of principal, the least credit risk, all that stuff, which has been a huge attraction to retirees and things like pensions and trusts and life insurance companies. Well, as the yields have been pushed down in the past number of years through this crazy time, the urge to go find yield somewhere else has been extremely strong. And what has happened is all these pop-up opportunities have come for less than scrupulous purveyors of risk and product, selling it to fill this void of reasonable income opportunities for people. At the same time, there's been, as I said, a bunch of infusion of money handed out to everyone on the so-called on the investor side in the financial system. So you've had a whole explosion of alternative special purpose vehicles, trusts, private equity, all these sort of in the fringes, financial purveyors of product and service, and they attract people with these ads about, you know, you can get these rates of return that are sort of 6, 7, 8, 9% a year, and they're calling them guaranteed. Well, of course, when the risk-free rate in the banking system is 0.25, there is nothing guaranteed about a rate of return that's promising to be 6, 7, 8. That's your benchmark, right? So it shows you that you're really off the reservation here in terms of a proxy for anything guaranteed, and yet people pay very little attention typically to the details of this stuff. Some of it is intentionally opaque and complex. That's the whole nature of how to pull one over on folks. But folks tend to be very susceptible to this because they want to believe that they can retire at you know, 55 or 60 or whatever the age is with insufficient savings, and someone's going to make them enough income off of it that they don't have to worry. And we saw that, you know, in the last couple of years where a lot of people who weren't intending to retire suddenly thought, oh, you know, I've got more, my house has gone up a lot, I've got my stocks are rebounding, these people are showing me these products, they say I can make 5 or 6 or 7% a year on safely in retirement. None of that is actually true, but that's what they bought into because it fulfilled their, you know, it coincided with their desire to leave the workforce early. So now, of course, we're seeing a lot of the fallout of that, and this is really particularly the case, again, in the mortgage and realty markets because we've had such a wildfire of people being attracted to that space and this whole mania around property prices only go up and everything's a good investment regardless of price. This is all the typical slogans. So we're seeing, you know, the various cases already hitting where, you know, the wheels are coming off, where the companies are not, you know, are vanishing with proceeds, where investors are trustees are coming in and winding down companies, and there's a big, you know, millions of dollars missing for the investor class that put funds in. And again, there's a lot of buzzwords here, you know, this whole fund to flip mentality, this whole, we're hassle free, you know, all that. That's typically real warning signs for people that, you know, someone's going to charge them a fee and take their capital basically into harm's way, and they're not guaranteed in the slightest. So, you know, right now we have, for example, the highest concentration of equity type products held by households as a percentage of their net worth that we've ever seen since 1999 and 1969. And both of those were secular peaks in the stock market, whereafter stocks then fell in value for the next 15 years, basically, 15 to 20 years thereafter, and didn't recover their prior peak for a couple of decades. So during that time, they lost sort of 50% of their value plus, and the people that were owning at the top, you know, ended up selling very low and liquidating and having to go back to work and running back to the safety of things like GICs and government bonds. Right now, the preponderance of people that are owning government bonds are like 2.5%, which is historically at the all-time low, just as they've migrated to these much higher risk products. So these trends really all line up, and I'm saying that, you know, yields have backed up so much in a very quick period of time. The total return for the safest bonds, the investment quality bonds, has fallen 11%. In the first quarter of March, the first quarter to the end of March, which is actually about as bad as bear markets and bonds have ever been historically. And typically you get a big rebound after that, where people have to reweight back towards this asset class. And also because stocks, yes, they've rallied since March the 14th, we've had this big rebound, but we're still, as I say, having the worst quarter for stocks that we had since March of 2000. So there's a bunch of losses going on the equity side at the same time that the bonds sold off. And, you know, the leverage on leverage within the system has a liquidation event as prices fall, where people are forced to sell and buy back, you know, things or move towards cash or sell assets. And I think that we're really starting to see that across a lot of assets all at once. Already I've noticed a lot of the realtors that I follow have been talking about the, you know, a drying up of people making bids or, you know, having showings. There's also been a lot of this option trading stuff in the realty market, Jim, where people have been buying options to purchase a property and buying and selling them without actually, you know, closing on the property. So the amount of speculation has just been ridiculous. And these ridiculous cycles have a way of ending in the same way, which means typically a lot of losses and liquidation, a lot of bad debt written off, a lot of price declines, and then opportunity eventually for people that have cash.
I noticed that you quoted a friend of the show, Steve Soretsky, who's a regular guest, and he's noted that what's going on in the real estate market, although I guess as a real estate agent, the higher the price, the higher the commission, it's nice personally. But he also deals with the human side, and he finds it's devastating to see the look in young people's eyes who want to buy a home for their family, and they just can't do it.
Right. Yeah.
Now,
and it's, you know, I own real estate as well. So yes, my net worth has gone up with this big pop in the last couple of years, but I would happily give back a bunch of that because I know how destructive this is, both for our country, for our economy, for our society. And it, as I've said many times, it isn't progress to have your housing prices double in a couple of years. It's actually the opposite of progress. It's actually set you up for, you know, giving a lot of that back and for a lot of people getting hurt. A lot of people who bought in, 45% of the people who bought in the last year during this mania phase, did so with variable rate mortgages, you know, which were, you know, less than 1.5%. And as the Bank of Canada hikes rates or expects to in the months ahead, you're going to see that a sort of a doubling of that with the variable rates going above 3%. Again, these kinds of increases are not, there's no flexibility in household budgets to accommodate this. And more importantly, when you get this kind of a big jump, you can also see a mean reversion in prices that's equally as large, and people never appreciate this because they have this erroneous conception that, you know, that housing never goes down, aided and abetted by central bankers like Ben Bernanke, if you recall, in 2006, making, or Greenspan, all the former Fed heads saying that they didn't think housing ever went down. Well, clearly it does and has repeatedly, and that's the most common outcome. So the people that bought, or worse, many people refinanced as their properties went up in the last couple of years and gouged the equity back out of that. Sadly, a lot of them did things like, you know, borrowing against the equity in their house to consume, which is just money that's gone now, but also to try and lever themselves into other asset classes, which were also, you know, very high risk, and borrowing to lend to other people who were, you know, speculating on real estate themselves. So you've got this really terrible house of cards built here, and I think what's really going to happen is that we're going to see a ratcheting down of the expectation of how much hikes can actually take place, because as I say, the rates have already moved just with the telegraphing of what central banks want to do because the bond market's already discounted that, and when you see that the waiver in all the assets that starts to happen because of that higher carrying cost, I think we're going to see a scenario like 2000 where central banks were hiking, you know, everything was lovely because the tech stocks were on fire and everyone was delighted. And then, of course, they did a hike. This is the last time they actually did get a half point hike off. Amazingly, it was in May of 2000. So long ago, Jim, like coming up 22 years ago was the last time the U.S. Central Bank actually had the courage to hike a half a point, which they're now predicted to do at the May, June, and July meetings, never mind quarter points after that. And, of course, what happened was they were on that same confident hiking trajectory in 2000, and when they hiked a half point, the stock market had actually, the tech sector had already peaked in March of 2000 that year along with the S&P. The Dow had already peaked by December of 1999. The TSX went on to rally again just like it has in the last little while with oil prices and commodity prices. It continued to rally into August of 2000 and then everything collapsed by 50 to 80%. So they never did hike past that first half point leap in May of that half point increase they did in May of 2000, and I think that's very likely what's going to happen this time. For all their brave talk, the reality is once asset prices start to tumble, as they're already doing, and the housing market freezes up, which is this huge monster we've created now, much worse than it was in 2000 or 2008 when it comes to Canada, for example, that you're going to see them recant on their conviction to follow through with the rate hikes, and then you're going to see a big rally in the bond market again, certainly on the high-quality stuff, not the corporate side, because the corporate side is very levered at this point and having trouble making their own payments. So anyway, I think that we're going to see the bond market rally again, rates roll back down, but that doesn't mean that asset prices will continue to deflate. Mm-hmm.
And Danielle, I just have to mention this. I think it's one of the most Canadian of all headlines. Mastermind of giant Quebec maple syrup heist ordered to pay $10 million fine. You won't hear that headline in any other country.
Well, I didn't see that headline, but it's something to do with the maple syrup cartel, I suppose.
Yes.
Fixing prices and that sort of thing.
No, this guy just masterminded a giant heist of Quebec's finest maple syrup, $10 million worth, and the Court of Appeal has said he was given a $1 million fine. They said, no, he took $10 million worth of maple syrup. It manipulated, it did end up manipulating the market, and he shouldn't get away with a fine any less than the quantity and amount of what he stole. So he's now been ordered to pay a $10 million fine instead of $1 million. But again, the most Canadian headline ever, $10 million fine for Quebec maple syrup heist.
Well, there you go. I do hope we get back to the principle, the sentencing principles in this country of disgorging the profits of crime, because that is something that has to happen in terms of any kind of deterrence. And that's something that in the finance sector has been allowed to go on way too long, people paying cost of business fines, keeping the bulk of the profits. And there's just no incentive to adhere to the law at all when you're allowed to become enriched by breaking it.
Yes, all too often we've seen the perpetrators of commercial crime ordered to pay a fine that amounts to 0.112% of their total profits.
And I think we're due for another here. Speaking of the cycle and the catharsis, yeah. I think we're due here for a period where the professionals that have enabled and embedded the bubbles and the money laundering and all the abuses that have gone on in this system, and I'm talking here not just about the realtors and mortgage brokers and lenders, but also the accountants and lawyers. There's been a lot of unsavory stuff gone on, and it's being highly documented right now. And I think that once prices actually start imploding, I think you're going to see a lot of people coming after the people who really were the cogs that enabled this system to get so distorted and broken in the first place. So it's going to be a period of discomfort on many levels, I think.
Danielle, thank you so much for chatting with us, and I hope spring finally gets sprung in Ontario.
Yes, thank you.
My guest has been Danielle Park, editor of the popular blog Juggling Dynamite and president of Venable Park Investment Council, Incorporated. Her website's jugglingdynamite.com, recommended reading there, and venablepark.com. If you have any questions for Danielle or any of our other guests, you can send them to info@howstreet.com and we'll ask that question on your behalf. Our YouTube channel, Talk Digital Network. Find us on Twitter at House Street. We're also on Facebook. I'm Jim Goddard. Thank you for listening.
Comments made on HowStreet.com radio are an expression of opinion only and should not be construed in any matter whatsoever as recommendations to buy or sell any financial instrument at any time. Available online at TalkDigitalNetwork.com. HowStreet.com Radio is a production of How Street Media Incorporated.